So, pleasant good morning to you all. On behalf of SBC once again, so I welcome you all for the second day of this ATL sponsored faculty development program on earthquake resistant design, earthquake resistant structural systems and design for buildings and structures. It's organized by the Department of Civil Engineering of SBCE. So I'm very much happy to welcome Professor Dipendra Punia from BITS Pilani. So he's going to take a session on seismic design of structures and overview and performance-based seismic design. So may I now request Ms. Ruby Freya, co-coordinator of this program, to introduce Professor Dipendra Punia to the participants.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm honored to introduce the speaker for the session, Dr. Dipendra Punia, associate professor of BITS Pilani. He has done his BE and ME in Bengal Engineering College, Howrah. He did his PhD in earthquake engineering, specializing in the field of structural dynamics in IIT Roorkee. He has 14 years experience in teaching and is the affiliated member of American Society of Civil Engineers. His research interests are performance-based seismic design, earthquake-resistant design of structures, concrete technology, energy-efficient building, structural health monitoring and rehabilitation, earthquake-resistant design of structures. He has already completed 3 research projects and current one is on waste management of generated sludge from Indian steel and steel-related plants under the Ministry of Steel, Government of India. He has collaborated for research with Asian Smart Cities Research Innovation Network, La Trobe University, Australia, the University of Thessaly, Greece, Trinity College, Dublin, and Ireland India Concrete Research Initiative. He has been a visiting academic to the Trinity College, Dublin under ISCA Ireland India Science Foundation Program and University Immersion Program, BITS Pilani. He has authored more than 63 publications in journals and conferences in an international repute. He is also reviewing books and journals and delivered many guest lectures. He is currently handling estate management unit as a faculty in charge in Pilani campus. He is very active at college and has organized workshops, conferences, etc. Being the earthquake engineering, his core area of research, he is the apt person for the session. I welcome you once again, sir.
Thank you for the introduction, Ms. Rubia. And thank you for giving this opportunity to share my views about this particular topic. Basically, put it for today's presentation, that is seismic design of structures and performance-based seismic design. So this is basically based on, so I hope that overall at least you have some idea. So today we are just going to discuss a little bit in detail so that we can have more idea about this topic and gain some kind of confidence and interest also. Maybe after the presentation, I am hoping for that. So in this topic or in my presentation, what there are 4 agendas. So one agenda, which is mentioned in the first point, that is mainly related to the seismology, what is earthquake, types of earthquake, how earthquake occurs, measurement of earthquake, causes and effects of earthquake and seismic waves. And this is basically mandatory for everyone. This, although some structural engineers also, some, I'm telling you some, not all, they normally feel that what is the use of this? If you give me the bearing capacity and the zone, then I can easily design it. So something like that. But yes, seismic idea also is required for structural fellow as well as the all other fellow also, even all earthquake engineers, those who are dealing this earthquake or designing the earthquake resistant design of structures, then they must know actually, at least up to some extent. So that is why I had kept the first point, and my aim is to finish it within 15 minutes. Then the next agenda that will be coming, that is actually our presentation, in today's presentation, that is seismic performance and design, with 2 case studies I have kept, if time permits, and this I will basically finish it within 30 minutes. then performance based seismic design and future developments. That I will be finishing another 30 minutes, hopefully. So I am overall, I am trying my best to finish it within 75 minutes. So now, in continuation, so I'm going to the next slide. So what is earthquake? Everyone knows that it is a natural disaster, or it is known as natural hazard also. It destroy means cities as well as the towns, and also loss to the human life. Basically, it depends on the magnitude and intensity. And it so don't think that when we feel the earthquake, that means that that time only earthquake happens. No, it is wrong idea. Every now and then, all over the world, the earthquake is happening. But yes, the magnitude intensity is very low. That is why we won't feel, means we won't feel when the magnitude intensity will be more. Especially the intensity will be more, then we will feel. Now, what happens after earthquake? So the background picture is the example of this, the after effect of the earthquake. So the ground surface is divided into two separate and the fire also basically happened. So this was happened after earthquake. So what is earthquake? Earthquake is basically the vibration. So when the earthquake comes, the vibration will happen, and that vibration is something like similar to the ripples in the water, which is showing in this slide also, the left side figure. And the right side figure is showing that where the origination of the earthquake. It is mainly inside the earthquake, inside the ground, and normally we can understand that this is underlying rock. So there, the focus, that is the origination of the earthquake. But from the ground surface point of view, we normally call it as epicenter, which is a perpendicular line to the focus, to the ground surface, from the focus to the ground surface, that is the epicenter. And it is very popular term, the epicenter of the earthquake. Because of the ground surface, it is visible. But inside the ground, it is not visible. So focus, basically the focus, but we normally term this particular term epicenter. So where is the epicenter of the earthquake? So that people can understand, okay, how long distance we are staying, whether the effect will come. So like way it will go on. So in epicenter, at the epicenter, the earthquake happens, then the seismic, the vibration also it is showing. The waves are coming just like this, and the plate also movement. So there are two plates, it will be moved the different direction, forth and back, that position. And nearby the heart, here it is showing, it is broken totally. So slowly, surely it is broken. You can see there, the one side of the wall, it is showing the damage. Now coming to the next one, that how earthquake occurs. For this, we have to know the different layers of the earth. So the extreme layer of the earth is known as the crust, which the depth is 5 to 40 kilometers. It's mentioned there, and it is normally situated at the sea. Normally, we can understand the sea bottom nearby the mountain. And next layer is the mantle. That is, the depth is 120 kilometers. And normally, this region is basically the culprit for origination of the earthquake. And here, the what happens, which I am going to discuss in the next slide, that plastic molten rock and the lithosphere, this is known as the lithosphere region also. So due to that, when it will be molten, that will be hot. When it comes to the earth, then it will be cooling down. So the difference that difference in displacement will occur, and because of that, the earthquake happens. So we'll go to the next one so that you can understand. Next layer is known as the outer core. That is, the depth is 1 to 90 kilometers, and it is very dense. Only the primary waves can pass. So primary waves, it is basically nothing but the part of the seismic waves or type of the seismic wave. It is known as also body waves, which we will be discussing in the latter slides also. Then after outer core, the inner core is also there. So these are the four layers that we should know, and so that we can understand that how earthquake happens and how to deal our design, especially from the structural point of view, so that the structure should not be damaged normally, so that we cannot lose our own people, own friends, own relatives. So for this, these today's presentation have been arranged. So anyhow, so continental plates, this is very, very important. So because this is related to this, how earthquake happens. So continental plates, there are several plates are showing in this particular slide. There are, I think here, seven plates are showing. And in India, there are two plates. Now see this, that is nearby the Himalaya. So Eurasian plate, because this is the plate boundary, the red color, red border line is showing the boundary line, that plate boundaries. So Eurasian plate and the Australian plate. Okay? And the direction of the movement is showing in the arrow sign. So when this different, this movement is different, then the drift will happen, and due to the drift, the earthquake can happen. So how it will happen? It is showing in this slide only. So evolved from continental drifts, it is known as also plate tectonic theory. So it is evolved from continental drift. There are difference in the displacement in the two different plates, or maybe number of different plates. And this happened because of the convective circular of Earth mantle, which is showing in your left side figure of this slide. So, and then the hot mantle cools as it comes up and forms an additional crust inducing thrust, which is known as the subduction process. Accordingly, the motion takes place through sliding of lithosphere, which is, I just now told you that in mantle, that particular layer is known as normally the lithosphere region. And there itself, this motion takes place through sliding of lithosphere in pieces called as tectonic plates. So this is this way the earthquake can happen. And more or less, we can also summarize in this way, which is showing in this particular slide, that underground rock suddenly breaks along a fault, then faults at plate boundaries are likely location of the earthquake, and slip creates new faults, and fault causes earthquake. And sudden release of energy, so when earthquake happens, then sudden release of energy happens, and that causes a seismic wave, which makes the ground shaking. We can also understand in our way, it is in our way. So you can take a piece of paper, and then you just use your two hands, and you have to move your hands forth and back. So one particular hand will be direction, will be one direction, the other hand will be the other direction. So automatically you will see that a fault will appear, and after that the vibration, because you have to movement, that movement will be very fast, so that the fault will appear like that. And after that, definitely you can understand. So you can use a piece of paper, piece of block. You can, that block should not be very solid or very stiff. It should be soft also. Then you can understand this. So based on this idea, we can categorize the types of earthquake. There are mainly two types. One is interplate earthquake, which is mainly the two plates movement is different, and because of that the earthquake happens. So which is showing in the first figure, what is happening, that plate B plate is there, and this is the mantle region, that is a mantle layer actually in the earth. So plate A subducts under plate B, and it dragging plate B with itself. Then what happened, plate B tries to return to its original position, and when it tries to return to its original position, then tensile stress will be generated, and because of that the causing an earthquake. Another type is known as the intraplate earthquake, which is the in the same plate, the movement is different, and it is basically compressive stress kind of that it will happen, and because of the earthquake can occur. Based on this, there are two types of earthquake normally we'll consider. Measurement of earthquake, it is a seismograph. Everybody knows about it. So seismograph is basically the working principle is nothing but the simple pendulum with a pen at its tip. And with a single degree of freedom system, normally we'll consider when it is a simple harmonic motion, that means single degree of freedom system. Now in this figure, it is showing that when earthquake motion, due to the earthquake, the motion is like this. Then on a paper, the simple pendulum with a pen tip is basically drawing this particular graph, which is a acceleration versus time duration graph. So from there, we can understand that what is the intensity. So mainly the seismograph measure the intensity in M scale. And this M scale is basically known as that MM1. So MM1 is, means normally nobody can fail. Very few people, that is MM1. At the same time, MM12, that is a completely devastating, that means very high intensity, means maximum intensity of the earthquake. So all buildings are damaged and most buildings are destroyed. Similarly, the another measurement of the earthquake is there, that is known as the magnitude of the earthquake, which is normally measured by the Richter magnitude, not mentioned it here. So magnitude, when it is 2 or less, then it is rarely felt, and when it is 9 or more, then it can collapse all the buildings. So what are the causes of the earthquake? Causes, as I have told you, the tensile stress or the compressive stress, or the volcanic eruption. So volcanic eruption showing in this particular figure also. So volcanic eruption also can cause the earthquake. So rock fall, landslides, explosion. Then what are the effects? Effects we know all. Down motion can move, ground motion will start, landslides can start, which is showing in this figure. Liquefaction can start, and tsunami. Tsunami also in this figure it is showing. So these are the effects of the earthquake. So definitely question will come that then what are the waves are there? So seismic waves. There are mainly two types, body wave and the surface wave. Now in the body waves, which is in compression in nature, there are two types again, the primary wave and secondary waves. Whereas surface waves, it is slowly and very dangerous. Rayleigh waves and Laave waves. And among it, the Laave waves is very dangerous, because Laave waves normally people can understand or relate with the earthquake also. Although this all are seismic waves, all are related to the earthquake, but when Laave waves come, then it is very dangerous, very dangerous. Okay, anyway. Whatever may be the dangers I have told, but finally, conclusion is that earthquake do not kill the people. We the people who claims that we are very good designers, then sometimes what happens, because of some issues, which I do not want to discuss it here. So that means it is basically going into the different direction, that is improperly designed. If we do the improperly design, then the building will collapse, the road can damage everybody. So human loss also will happen. So that is why it is mentioned that we have to do the proper design. Either you have to learn proper design, or if you know the proper design, do not compromise for due to anything. Okay, anyway. So what are the techniques behind this design? So this is overall known as the seismic design, so or seismic performance and design, because performance we should know, based on that we can go for the design. So what are the performance that we have to always focus as a designers? Normally in any structure, two functions we categorize, that is safety and serviceability. We cannot compromise these two factors. So safety is very much concerned during the project also, and after the project also, even before the project also. And serviceability, so it should be serviceable. Even after designing and construction of your building and roads, it should be serviceable. Serviceable means it can work in conditions. So even damage may be there, but it is repairable, like that actually. Anyway. So based on that, the design methods also are there, which we know normally, force-based method, other one is the displacement-based method. Now normally in the force-based method, seismic design point of view, these are the four different methods can be coming. One is known as the equivalent lateral static procedure, other one is the response spectrum, then seismic coefficient, then time history. Whereas displacement-based design, normally performance-based seismic design, nowadays we normally consider, even not nowadays, even when it is evolved, that from the day itself that displacement-based design, basically, it is coming into the category of a displacement-based design. Because we have to control the displacement, we have to then find out that which level it is basically coming, which what is the force level or something like that. So these are the codes, various codes, IS 1893 part 1, very, very important code for earthquake resistant design purposes. And other than that, part 2, part 3, part 4 under IS 1893, even part 5 is also there, which is dam and embankment structures, not mentioned in this slide. Similarly, IS 4326, IS 13827, so and more than that, the IS 13920, this is very, very important, because this will give you the earthquake resistant design along with the ductile detailing. Now, what is ductility? We will going to discuss also. Other than that, IS 800, IS 456, those are the basic codes for design of steel structure as well as the RCC structures. We should not neglect, because those are the basic codes always required for any time, means for anything, any design. So the first approach, which is force-based approach, equivalent static method, or it is also known as seismic coefficient method. The design bezier is computed for the whole building, then it is then distributed along the height of the building, and then the lateral load forces on each floor are distributed to individual resisting elements. Now, question will come that how to design, find out the design bezier. So again, it is IS 1893 part 1. Nowadays, that 2016 code, present code also, recent code also came up. So VB equal to H into W. So design bezier is VB, H is the seismic coefficient, horizontal seismic coefficient, and W is the seismic weight of the building. And the seismic coefficient is there, that is why it is also known as the seismic coefficient method. Anyway, so this is your VB equal to HW. Now, what is H? H is Z by 2 I by R SA by G. Z is the zone factor, I is the importance factor, R is the reduction factor, SA is the acceleration, spectral acceleration, G is the acceleration due to gravity. Now, Z, you know that there are in our code, IS 1893 part 1, they have given us zone 1, zone 2 to zone 5. Zone 2 is the very minimum intensity of the earthquake, and zone 5 is very high, means maximum. I is importance factor, that how much important of that building is. SA, you know, so, but SA by G, it is known as the coefficient of seismic acceleration, which depends on the fundamental time period. And this fundamental time period also can be obtained from the these two equations which are available in the code, without brick infill or with infill. Both the conditions, it is given there. So we have to measure this fundamental time period, and from there, SA by G we can obtain. Now, SA by G we can obtain from the, there is a graph which is known as the, basically that is known as the response spectrum graph. So from there, SA by G, we can find it out. It depends on the soil condition also. Anyway, whether it is medium soil, soft soil, or hard soil, or rock soil, that is also there. So from there, we can calculate the H, and W is the seismic weight, which includes the gravity load mainly, and includes dead load and some partial percentage of the, or some percentage of the live load. So using that W we can, so after calculating the VB, so this VB, we can, so using this equation, this is also given in your IS code 1893 part 1, we can calculate the at each floor the lateral forces, which is QI. So each floor the lateral forces we can find out. After getting the lateral forces, then what else? Then you have to model in your software. Nowadays software is available. Various softwares are available. Commercial software package is also available. So you can model in the software and apply this load, lateral load, and then find out the results. That's it. Either shear, moment, axial force, even not only that, the deflection also. But the limitations also are there of this particular method. That is either the equivalent static method or the seismic coefficient method. These methods cannot be applicable in a high seismic zone and high-rise structures. What happens? High seismic zone, high-rise structures, it is going into the nonlinear region. That means inelastic region, most of the cases. It is not strict to elastic limit. So there is a chance to going into the nonlinear region. But nonlinear region or inelastic region, this method is not applicable. This is only applicable for the earth elastic level. That means which obeys the Hooke's law. And it also cannot be used in the buildings having high modes of vibration. It is again related to that nonlinear effect. High modes of the vibration will come. High modes means higher mode. Higher mode will only come when your structure is basically process that particular elastic limit, then only higher modes effect will come. And this higher mode effect will be applicable only when if discontinuities are there. Discontinuities means it is not symmetric, either in plan, either in elevation, material point of view. So then you have to basically higher mode effect you have to consider. And if you consider the higher mode effect, then this method is not applicable, because this method totally based on your fast mode mainly. For a building, it is kind of a cantilever effect, and for other beam or something like that, it is a normal beam deflection that So these are the limitations. Similarly, the response spectrum method, it is known as the dynamic analysis, linear dynamic. Again, it is valid within the elastic limit. So that is why it is linear dynamic analysis method. And in this method, multiple mode shapes of building are taken into account. It can be, which is not there in earlier two methods. But and also for each mode shape, response is read from the design spectrum based on the modal frequency and modal mass, and they are then combined to provide an estimate of the total response of the structure using modal mass combination methods. Now these combinations can be done using these three techniques. One is known as the absolute sum method. Other one is known as the square root sum of squares, that is SRSS, very, very popular, and complete quadratic combination. Then we have to calculate the design Bessier, which is termed as VB bar, and we have to check or compare with the calculated Bessier VB using the earlier procedure, that is a static analysis method. And if the VB is less than VB bar, then all the response quantities, that is member force, story displacement, story forces, base reaction, story shears, will be multiplied by the VB by VB bar. So this is the whole technique of this response spectrum method, which is known as also linear dynamic analysis. But again, the limitations are there. That is, building with plan irregularities and vertical irregularities cannot be modeled. And for irregular buildings less than 40 meter in height in zone 2 and 3, which may be not mandatory, but is recommended. So that means, again, it is not recommended for the inelastic region. So the modal mass, some of the equations also given in your code, modal mass will be basically calculated using this equation given in your this clause. But this clause, remember this clause actually from your earlier code, earlier version, IS code 1890 part 1 2016, please check it out. I think it is 7.7.5.4. I think so. I forgot it, but I think so, which I forgot to actually correct it. Similarly, the modal participation factor, we can calculate using this equation. Again, the clause may be little changed because of the new code. The new code means new version of the code, 2016 version code. There is a only clause change, but the equation same. And then also we can find out the design lateral force at each floor in each mode. Then after getting this lateral force in each mode, then we can find out the shear storage shear in each mode. Then after that, we have to use the combination, either complete quadratic combination, that is CQC, either SRSS or either absolute sum method. Now, normally the CQC, it is when the two consecutive modes, the natural frequency difference is within the 10%, then this CQC is applicable. If it is more than 10%, then SRSS. And absolute sum method, it is means I can request not to use, right? Earlier, the people were using it and they have also kept it. But yes, the erroneous results, sometimes it comes. So that is why better to not to use. Then after doing that combination, then we can find out the lateral forces at each story due to all modes considered using this particular equation. So at the roof level, lateral force F roof can be equal to V roof. But after that, next level, that is next lower level, Fi will be equal to Vi minus Vi plus 1. So these two equations will help you to find out the lateral forces at each story or at each floor for considering all modal effect. Now this response spectrum method can be, means we can also get into detail if we consider this numerical example problem. But I am very quickly going through this because time limit is also there at the same time. So I should focus on that also. So a four-storied RC building is there. Special moment resting frame is considered. Now, what is special moment resting frame? That also will be discussed in the latter slides. But please make a note, situated at zone 3, type 2 soil. Type 2 soil is medium soil in India, is analyzed using response spectrum analysis with and without considering of the infill panels. And these are the data. Other input data is also given. The plan and elevation also mentioned along with the dimensions. So it's not dimension actually. It is mentioned as V and L and H. So what we have normally done it, we basically do the lump mass model in the software after getting this particular data. Lump mass model and do the modeling in the software, any software. Nowadays SAP is available, then ETAPS is available. Not only that, the commercial software package STAT is also available, STAT Pro. So you can use any of the commercial software package, do the model in that, and then use the response spectrum method. There is an option, response spectrum is option is there, and then you do the analysis. You will get the results in terms of shear moment and axial force. So then you, after that, you just do the design. So similar exercise, we have to do it here. What we have found out it here, we have found out or determined the shear and displacements. One is considering the infill, other one is considering the without infill. And for the story level 4, which is roof level, we are getting the shear maximum or more in comparison with the infill, which is obvious. Similarly, displacement is very, very less in comparison with the without infill. Also, it is very obvious. So finally, that means that the modeling which you have done and the analysis you have done, that is correct. And finally, the outcome is that when you use the infill, you can visualize or you can get it idea that story shear increase, but displacement decrease considerably. The another example also we have considered it here, that is a ground plus four story office building. It is in seismic zone 5, and these are the data already mentioned. And it is basically you have to do it the design of a particular beam, that is also they have mentioned, that is the design of the beams along the grid line 2. And this will be detailing will be done as per IS 13920-1993. And here, why they have considered the seismic coefficient method, because they have considered this particular example as regular building, and the height should be less than 16.5 meter. And as per the clause of the 2002 code says that dynamic analysis need not be carried out. Seismic coefficient method is enough. And that is why they have considered this. So these are the plan using along with the dimensions. And this is the elevations in different frame. This is the member sizes for both for column and beams. The cross sections actually is given there. This is the dead load and this is the live load for the particular frame. This is our other input. Then these are the load combinations which have been considered. And then they did the analysis in the software and find out the results for individual dead load, due to the dead load, due to the live load, due to the earthquake load along the y direction. Now, why y direction? It may be the shorter direction. So shorter direction, as you know, that the earthquake, due to the earthquake or the lateral force effect is more in comparison with the longer direction. That is why earthquake Y they have considered. Earthquake X not considered. Then after getting this, then they have used the combination and find out the worst scenario, worst value, maximum value for different point, different location of the beam AB. So left end, center, and right end. And then based on this data, both shear and moment, because beam always designed using the shear and moment. So they have considered accordingly. And they have designed it. So design as per the IS code 456. And that is why I have told you that 456, you have to always consider. Not only 456, along with the SP6 and the ductile detailing code, that is IS 13920. They have considered and find out the summary of required enforcement. They have summarized the top will be 1.46%, bottom will be 0.945%. Similarly, top will be 0.37%, bottom will be 0.37%, and top will be 1.47%, and bottom will be 0.79%. So, this I have already told you, this is for longitudinal enforcement, and this is the detailing. So cross section A is basically situated at the left end, and cross section BB is situated at the center, and cross section CC it is situated at the right end, extreme right end. So this has been also shown. So this is all about your using the seismic coefficient method. How do we design it and detail it also? I hope that there is no problem. So we'll discuss later on after end of my presentation. Then we are going to the time history analysis. Now, what happens? Because here we have kept it as non-linear dynamic analysis. It doesn't mean that time history analysis is not valid for the linear dynamic analysis. Time history analysis is also applicable for the linear dynamic analysis also. But in compared with the response spectrum, time history analysis and considering the linear dynamic analysis, it will take too much of time. Whereas response spectrometer, very quickly you will get the results and do the design, and then you can sell your design also to the market. So that is the reason that linear dynamic analysis, as linear dynamic analysis, you consider the time history analysis, not good. You unnecessarily wastage your time. Whereas linear dynamic analysis, response spectrum method is not valid. As I have already told you, response spectrum method only valid for elastic level. Up to elastic point, it is valid. So inelastic level, it is not valid. Whereas time history analysis is valid for non-linear dynamic analysis. And as you know that time history analysis is a force-based approach, so that is a force-based approach also. So I'm not going into this procedure. If you have any doubt, we can discuss later on. Now coming to the directly the performance-based seismic design. It is a very, very important design concept under the seismic design of structures nowadays, especially in Indian aspect. Although till now, no Indian courts have incorporated this idea, but we are trying our best to incorporate, ask them to, because the members are also there from our faculty members, but we are requesting them that please input, but let's see when it will come in the highest courts. But it is very, very important aspect. Don't think that this is my area, that is why I am just try to convince you. It is not like that. This is a very, very important, because this performance-based seismic design, it is not only design, it is basically kind of a checking. If you do your design using your response spectrum method or the seismic coefficient method, then you have to check in a nonlinear way, means in the inelastic region also, that which level that structure is belonging to for that particular region. Until and unless you will get that idea, you won't be getting confidence about yourself that whether it will collapse or whether it will not collapse, it will just damage, but it is repairable or not, like that. So this performance-based seismic design, that is why, and this is basically type of one of the seismic design method under displacement-based approach. Because here we have to control the displacements and then find out the force level. So up to, suppose there are various levels, up to when it reaches the maximum level, then how much force will be required? And when that much of force will be coming, then which type of zone it will give that much of force, we can have some kind of idea. So accordingly, we'll basically, after design the structure, we'll basically plan to construct accordingly. So that is why the performance-based seismic design is very, 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 very required. So under this, there are three parameters we have to focus. One is seismic performance level, which is the expression, the maximum acceptable damage in a structure subjected to earthquake motion or earthquake action. Second one is the seismic design level, which is the hazard of a site where the structure would be located. And seismic design objectives. This is nothing but the combination of these two, seismic performance level and the seismic design level. So, so these three parameters is very, very mandatory. And for a designers nowadays, even I can also share it. I'm not sure I can share it. Sometimes I also think that it is only valid for seismic aspects, or it is valid also for other aspects? Because in our regular life also, we normally use this concept. Although it is not known as performance-based seismic design, but it is known as performance-based design also, means optimum design or kind of that. So in our regular life also, that way we are controlling our life at the same time. And that is known as also disciplined life. Sometimes we can call it as also. Anyway, we can relate. So these are the codes. Now you are not getting any code from India. So no Indian standard mentioned there in this particular design technique. That means that this performance-based seismic design not yet involved or incorporated in Indian standard. All are, so ATC 33, it is Applied Technology Council 33. FEMA is Federal Emergency Management Agency code. Then ACOC, that is also VISAN. It is a US-based agency code. So these all are US documents. Similarly, Eurocode 8 also, they have incorporated this design technique, and Japan code also. All Japan codes incorporated this technique. Now, according to the Eurocode 8, the conventional criteria of this technique is it explicitly satisfies the level of performance. So one of the performance is, or performance level is life safety. Under a design level is nothing but the hazard where you are going to construct that particular structure. That is rare. Now, what is rare? What is life safety? That will be discussed in the latter slides. Then, next one is that limit the economic losses through a check of the damage limits for a frequent demand. Frequently is also another design level. Next, third one is the prevent the collapse under any circumstances, that is any unimaginable demand through a capacity design. Capacity design, it is a basically, we have to, whenever we design a structure, that is basically capacity curve or capacity design curve. So that is. And then after doing the design, then according to the seismic performance, that we have to construct that structure in a particular site. So finally, the procedure. What is the procedure involved in this performance-based design? We have to select the performance objectives. Accordingly, selection of the performance objectives. So performance objectives is the combination of the seismic design level and seismic performance level. So then we have to develop, accordingly we have to develop the preliminary design. And then we'll assess the performance capability. Assess performance capability means for that particular site, whether that particular structure, which is already preliminary design, it can okay or not, or whether it will fail. So then we'll check, does performance meet objectives? If it is no, then we'll go to again revise the preliminary design, or else we can change the performance objectives and it will continue till we achieve that performance meet the objectives. And if it will achieve the performance objective, that means that your preliminary design, if you, whatever you have done, even finally, that will be also acceptable. So this is the idea of the performance-based design. Now coming to the performance, as I told you that we'll discuss in the latter slides, what are the performance level and the seismic design level? Now this is actually given as per the Applied Technology Council, that means US-based agency documents. So in performance level, it is given in the Applied Technology Council 40, as well as the FEMA also, that is Federal Emergency Management Agency code also. So in the performance level, there are four levels mainly considered: fully operational, that means no damage happened, it is totally operational. Operational, damage happened, but it is repairable. Life safety means more damage happens, but it is again repairable, but it is saved against life of human. Collapse prevention, just before collapse, so all damage happens. So damages are huge, it cannot be repairable. So if you just push more forces, then it will be collapse. So that's just before collapse, that level is known as the collapse prevention level. These are the basic objectives. And seismic design level is frequent. frequent earthquake. So frequent earthquake, the return period given as 43 years. So once in 43 years, that frequent type of earthquake can come over that particular site. And that type of site, and it is normally 50% of the structure will be affected, and for this the 30 years design life will be considered. 30 years design life will be considered for those structures. If it is frequent, when we design the structure due to the frequent earthquake, then we have to give the design life as 30 years. And normally 50% of the structure will be affected due to that. Then occasionally, that is return period is 72 years, the 50 years will be the design life and 50% of the structure will be affected. Rare will be 475 years, the return period, 50 years will be design life and 10%, and very rare, there is a maximum considered earthquake level, which is 970 years. Once in 970 years, that particular type earthquake can come. And that is why, because it is a 970 years, very rare, the design life normally given to 100 years lifetime. Very, very rare, 10% only, 10% only affected. So 10% only if the earthquake can come, and that will be affected. And so according to that, now we have to choose the basic objectives. So for frequent and corresponding to the frequent design level, we have to choose the basic objectives as fully operational, as seismic performance level, occasional, it will be operational, rare, the basic objective should be life safety, and very rare, it should be collapse prevention. Why it is like that, we'll also, because when it is frequent, the acceleration level, the force level is very less in compared with the very rare. Occasional, it will be little more, rare, it will be more, but very rare will be maximum. So that will be explained it here. Now see this. This is the design level. So now when it is frequent, the acceleration level, it is very, very minimum in compared with other three. When it is very rare, that is maximum considered earthquake level, the acceleration level is maximum. And that is why the basic objectives in this particular case has been considered as collapse prevention, because structure can go to the collapse level also. So that is a collapse prevention level, we have to fix it as seismic performance level. And not only that purpose, at the same time, it will only comes once in 970 years. And design life also 100 years. So based on these views, it is basically fixed. So what are the assumptions behind it? Assumptions is like that nonlinear behavior, it is possible to transform the capacity curve in the behavior curve of an equivalent single degree of freedom system. And the behavior curve of an equivalent single degree of freedom system can be idealized as bilinear. Now, coming to the procedure, already I have discussed before it also with that chart. Through this slide also we can discuss, but this is particular given as per the American Concrete Institute, that one web session they have basically discussed. So that particular thing I have just copied and pasted here. So these are the different seismic performance level, operational, immediate occupancy, life safety, collapse prevention. And this is your seismic design level, frequent earthquake, intermediate earthquake, and extremely rare earthquake. So frequent earthquake, we have to check the seismic performance level as immediate occupancy, and intermediate earthquake level, we have to check the life safety level, and extremely rare earthquake level, we have to check the collapse prevention level. And accordingly, you have to basically design our structure. So even not only that, through that capacity curve, this is known as the capacity curve. This red line is the capacity curve, which is base shear versus roof displacement or structural displacement due to the earthquake intensity. So when it is linear, so at that linear, it is basically operational, no damage happened. When just it crossed the elastic limit, it is coming into the immediate occupancy, only few damages happen, but it can be repairable. And when it is totally nonlinear, then normally we'll consider as life safety level, where more damages happen, but it is also repairable. No problem, it is safe against the life. And just before collapse, now see this is the collapse point. Just before collapse, that is a collapse prevention level. And that means that the building cannot be repairable. It is just standing like that. It better to demolish and again construct the new structure there. Now, what we normally do it? We have to generate this capacity curve, which is basically done using, it is known as the design curve also. So which is base shear versus roof displacement or structural displacement. Then we have to convert into the spectral acceleration versus spectral displacement. And again, plot it here. And then we have to consider that demand curve. Demand curve, normally it is a response spectrum curve, which depends on the particular zone and the time period also, fundamental natural time period also. And that curve we have to basically, since this capacity curve is nonlinear behavior, so we have to basically consider this demand curve also nonlinear way. For this, we have to construct the reduced demand curve for inelastic capacity of the structure. So that will be done. It is given in your Anil Chopra book also, how to generate the inelastic design spectra. Normally, I am just directly now writing it. Means directly telling you that it will be nothing but that whatever the demand curve will be there, that divided by the mu. Mu is the ductility. So that ductility, you know that it is the maximum displacement to the initial displacement. Initial means the not initial, yield displacement. So that way you can find out the ductility as structural ductility, and that ductility you have to divide, you will get this reduced demand spectra. Now this reduced demand spectra and this capacity curve where it will be bisects, that point is basically known as the performance point, and that point will be considered that which level it is belonging to, whether it is life safety level, whether it is collapse prevention level, whether it is immediate occupancy level, whether it is operational level. So from this particular idea, we can say that this is a life safety level. So so when we get this life safety level, immediately we get the force level. So force level we can find out because spectral acceleration is SA and spectral displacement is SD. So after getting the SA, we can directly convert into the force, because as you know that the acceleration into mass will give you the force. Then we can find out the force, and after getting the force, what else? The force level, you can find out it, and due to the force you have designed or not, whether you have provided the cross section or not, that you can cross check, and accordingly you can understand that okay, this cross section can be revised. Okay, so that way we can do it. Nowadays this performance based seismic design is not only valid for the existing structures, it is also valid for the new structure at the same time. Basically the concept came from the existing structure, but nowadays it is applicable to the new structure also. So this is more clear picture. This is your, the green line is showing the demand curve, then the fluorescent line is showing the reduced demand curve, and then black line is showing the capacity curve, and the blue line is showing the idealized curve, and then this reduced demand curve where it is bisects this capacity curve, that will be the performance point. Now the capacity design, the another method which is related to the performance based design, it is basically a very basic method of the nonlinear design or nonlinear behavior of the structure. What is that? It says that weak beam strong column methodology, because if beam fails, then you have time to repair that. And beam fails normally in flexural way, flexural behavior way, which is normally known as the ductile behavior, because ductility is nothing but that before failure, number of warnings will get it. So that we want as a structural designer, so that we have the means we have the time to repair that portion, so that it will again come back to its original strength, almost original strength. Not fully 100% strength, at least 80 to 90% strength should be achieved. And if column fails, then what will happen? Column is fails is dangerous. Then total building will fail. And it is a brittle failure, which is known as the sudden failure. And it won't give you any time to repair. and it is a shear failure also. So that is why in the capacity design approach, they have told that we've been strong column methodology and we have to make ductile the beam, more ductile than the beam and also the column. But we want that beam should fail first in compared with the column so that total structure should be intact. This is evolved capacity design concept of the concrete members introduced by the Bling, Newmark and Corning 1961. That is also mentioned. So ductility, I have told you, what is ductility? Because this ductility concept came mainly because like our country is a very poor country. We normally do not want any damage, but ductility basically nothing but that we are allowing the damage. But why we are allowing the damage? Because we have very less money. And because of the less money, we have to always focus on the money point of view in compared with the life safety point of view. So for this, we have to optimize the cross section. We have to basically, whatever the reinforcement we'll provide there, whatever the steel we'll provide there, whatever the cross section we'll provide there, that should be optimum way. That should be minimum way. So that material point of view, as well as the cross-section point of view, every point of view, the cost will be coming finally minimum. That is the reason. But it is not also good. And I can say it is not also good. But yes, that is why capacity design approach also we should follow so that the beam should fail. If it will damage, then the damage will be started in the beam rather column. Okay, so that the structural structure intact. So that is why this ductility concept basically came. It basically control the cost also. So economical design of structure also, we can say, if we introduce or consider the ductility, right? So ductility and cost are basically related with each other. Initially, the reinforced concrete frames basically consider as earthquake resistant design of structure. Even nowadays also, it is not initially, nowadays also, but for this what happened, we are using some special moment resisting frame, which are can be shear wall, that will be discussed in the later stages, can be damping device, can be anything, means there can be base isolator, so that those are devices, but shear wall is a, directly we can use that particular frame as shear wall system, which basically giving you the special moment resisting frame, which will give you the more ductility. Normally, more ductility. If the ductility will be more, that is special moment resisting frame. If ductility will be less, then it will be either called as intermediate moment frames or the ordinary moment frames. So, this is special moment resisting frame. So, I'm not going into this much of detail. Again, we have to achieve the strong column with being designed. And look at this ductility. Before failure, number of warnings. So this will be ductility. We have the time to repair it. Whereas brittle, no time. It will fail suddenly. And this code always refer because I have told you that IS 13920. This is very, very important code. What happens when earthquake happens, that so much of energy will be dissipated. If the energy will be dissipated more, then normally we fail that, the ductility will get it more. Because the hysteresis loops, although I'm not showing it here anywhere, that is a hysteresis loop, because under that loop, the area of the energy distribution we have to calculate, and that area of the energy distribution will be more, then definitely there is a basically formula given in the ATC 40. Using that formula, when you calculate the ductility, it will always come to maximum. So that is the reason that we want more dissipation of the energy, and that more dissipation of the energy, that hysteresis loops is known as the stable hysteresis loop, which is not showing it here. I just here mentioned it extra. If you remember, it will be better. So these are the various classification as per the New Zealand standards. I hope that I am in time. Brittle structures, normally ductile structures, structures of limited ductility, ductile structures. Other than, and we know that these are the different structural elements and non-structural elements. So whenever we design it, we have to basically design in such a way so that, again, so that the column should not fail first, at least. The beam should fail, or beam should be damaged, or the slab also be damaged, but we have the time to repair it. Because these two are basically fail in a ductile way. in compare with the column. So these are the various earthquake resistant elements, shear wall, as we know already. So this is the plan of the shear wall, and we have provided in a very symmetric way. So we have to provide the shear wall in this symmetry. So basically the bold line, which is black, so bold line is showing that shear walls. The thickness is normally varying from 150 to 400 mm in high-rise buildings. It is valid in the high-rise buildings also. I mean, not only that, the low-rise building also. Basically, it is not preferable for an unsymmetric way. So unsymmetric location of the shear wall is not desirable. So symmetric location of the shear wall is desirable. As you know, because torsional effect will come then, which is very, very not preferable as a designers. So now look at this. So couple shear wall, this is a couple shear wall building long back. So 1964 Alaska earthquake. So it was happened. This is a 14 story building. So these are the shear walls. There are three shear walls and connecting coupling beam. So coupling beam happens, damage have been happened in the coupling beam, but it is still in intact. Nothing is done, only at the base. Now see that at the ground level maybe, first floor level, there is little damage happened in the shear wall, but other than that it is contact. So we have the time to repair it. There is no chance to falling down on the ground. So that is why this shear wall concept or the couple shear wall. Why couple shear wall? Because here the shear wall, number of shear wall connected with this coupling beam. Now this coupling beam normally we'll consider the diagonal reinforced coupling beam, which is showing in this figure. It may be some other type of reinforcement also provided in this coupling beam. So this is the free body diagram of this couple shear wall. Couple shear wall normally preferable when the building is very high. Normally it is more than 15 story. Normally we prefer that couple shear wall should be provided. And the action will be something like a cantilever action. So deflector shape point of view also we can understand that this is a cantilever pattern, whole couple shear wall system. And in the building, now see this, in the building, the contraflexure point occurs at the midpoint, and the deflection is also changing from the midpoint. So this is your concept of the couple shear wall. These are the various type of coupling beam with different reinforcement arrangement. This is the normal reinforcement, this is diagonal reinforcement, this is rhombic, or sometimes it is known as a truss reinforcement type. These are the various limit of the plastic rotation capacity of the coupling beam, because coupling beam is the beam which controls the whole shear wall. Two shear wall are the number of shear wall. So the shear wall will behave as a single entity. So the cost point of view, effectiveness point of view, construction point of view, the shear wall is very, very effective. Other than shear wall, the seismic dampers is the external device. You can put it there, control the whole system. There are various type of dampers are available. I am very quickly now going through it because this is available in the literature, in the Google, everywhere you can get it. But you can make a note that seismic dampers is also one of the earthquake resistant device. The bracing, steel bracing, that is diagonal steel bracing, that is also a very good earthquake resistant elements. Now in this building also they have provided this. Now see this, this is inverted bracing they have provided, and in this building the diagonal bracings to resist the earthquake lateral load, mainly earthquake. Actually earthquake happens, lateral load will come, then lateral load will be resisted. Not only that, the base isolator as lead rubber isolator provided in this building at the I think it is at the base, means on the ground, but at the base is provided there so that the energy will be dissipated and it will be absorbed. And it will basically control the deflection, overall control the deflection of the building due to the earthquake. Not only that, the lead rubber bearing as well as spherical sliding isolation is also there. Now see this particular base isolator provided after the huge earthquake 2001 in this particular building. It is in the basement. They have provided it to control this particular building finally. But this was basically provided after the earthquake because whole building almost intact. Only problem came up little bit at the basement. So there they have provided this and finally controlled the whole system. Till now it is working condition finally. So this is the concept of the performance business. I just thought that I have to just discuss with you a little bit in a methodical way. So what I have done it here, we have developed this technique, design technique, or it is known as the capacity curve technique, capacity design technique, approximate technique based on this free body diagram, based on the steps. So steps I'm not going into detail, it's not required. Then we have considered this data as case study, everything, the load data, the geometrical, the plan, etc., everything we have considered, and modeling in the SAP as well as the drain 3DX. Then we compare these results with our approximate this technique. Now, when you compare it, so this is your capacity design curve. This is for the fixed base condition, and we have also considered another hypothetical condition. Nowadays, this is valid, pin-based condition. Because rocker, we provide the rocker can be provided as a pin-based condition. So nowadays, they are providing it also, pin-based condition. So we are saying, getting that, almost same results we are getting, this capacity design curve. Then after generating this capacity curve, now this particular curve or this particular building, which is this, this we have thought that to construct in the Roorkee region. As a medium soil and maximum considered earthquake level as a design based earthquake level as per the IS code. So that time IS code part 1 2002, 5% damped elastic response factor, and Z we have considered as 0.24 for zone 4. So when we did that using the that technique, that SA by SD we have converted, then capacity curve also we have made it, capacity spectrum and design spectrum. Then reduced demand spectra also we have considered, and performance point. Now see, this performance point is coming at the collapse prevention limit, almost collapse prevention limit it is. Why? Because we have considered the maximum considered earthquake level, which is very rare, which is the return period is 970, but the acceleration level is maximum. That is why performance point in the Roorkee region, which we have designed the capacity curve we have developed, it is basically coming. Whereas for the design basis earthquake level, which is nothing but the I can compare with the intermediate earthquake level, which is the return period is maybe 72 years, once in 72 years, then we are getting it that it is coming in the immediate occupancy level, just after the yield level, immediate occupancy level, the performance point is coming, which is obvious. So this way we can check it that which level this is belonging in the Roorkee region for different level of earthquake, because earthquake level is the hazard level for that particular site. And accordingly, we can understand that which level it is. So finally, from this particular scenario, we can now conclude that although force-based design approach is nowadays also very popular, but due to some limitations, especially when it is going beyond the inelastic region, beyond the elastic region, when the structure building is high-rise or it is going to be constructed in the high seismic zones, then we must consider the displacement-based design approach also as a performance-based seismic design approach also as a displacement-based design, just to verify that whether it is okay or not. And in this aspect, we are recommending that the IS code should incorporate this particular performance-based design. So thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can ask. So I am very much actually happy to give you the answer if time permits. If not, then I have my email ID that maybe organizer can share with you, or maybe I can share with you in the chat box also. Yeah, thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can ask. Thank you.
So thank you, sir. Now it is open for discussion. So participants, if you have any questions, you can raise your questions to professor. can post your questions in the chat box, or you can unmute your mic and you can ask questions to the Professor Dipendra.
I hope that I have finished in time, right? I hope that I have finished in time. Am I okay? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Please proceed. Yeah.
Sir, one question I want to ask.
Yeah. Please mention your name so that and from where you are basically coming, so that I can also get it some idea.
Yeah, my name is Sayyed Imaduddin. I am from Jamia Millia Islamia. I am actually doing PhD in performance-based design of BESA accelerated RC buildings.
Okay, very good.
Yeah, and I want to know because as far as my exposure is concerned, I have seen that the buildings, the performance-based design is basically for the existing buildings. So where I can find out in the codes from here or from all other courts that it is also applicable for the new structures? I haven't found anywhere.
See, till now, as I have already told you, this is basically applicable to the existing structures. The concept basically came in the year of 1993, right? And the US agency, they have made some documents. That are documents, even I have also shown some of the documents. Even you are also aware because you are working in that particular field. That is Applied Technology Council, FEMA, and so many FEMAs came also. So many FEMAs actually. So basically you have to concentrate on those documents and then compare with your IS code. And accordingly you go for your design. What I have done during my PhD, I'm just telling you, don't take it my concept in your means. If you won't feel that comfortable, I must say that you should not consider. Right? It is just my experience I am sharing with you. What I have done it, I know my mechanics. So I know my IS code, what it says. And I know the design. So then I developed a design technique. And then I compare the results using that ATC 40's documents. And then wherever I am lagging, wherever I am basically, the difference is coming, I try to find out. And those parameters, again, I have incorporated. So that finally, two things, actually, it should maintain. So whatever the parameters they have considered, whatever the parameters I have considered, I should verify. And then accordingly, I have incorporated so that finally, the design technique should be acceptable to everyone. And why that is required, because in Indian context, there is no code yet. Although so many people are working. Even you go to Roorkee, now also so many students are working. Even you go to Kanpur, so many people are working. You go to even Bombay also, nowadays they have started. They are also working. So even here also, under my supervision also, they are also working. So everywhere it is working, but we have to basically request. So Roorkee fellows are there, the Delhi also is there, so Bombay is also there. We are requesting. Let's see when it will come up, but don't leave it. It is existing for the it is basically applicable for the existing structure, but you can think for the new structures also. Although it is, that is the research, that is your research. Everything is available all over the world. You are doing your research, right? You are doing your research. You are adopting that method in your way, right? So that we can understand your understanding. PhD does not mean that you will innovate something. PhD does not mean that you will discover something, right? It will take even your total life also. I mean, not only life, two lives or three lives. If you are constantly working on that area, it will take even, your generation will come up then. Your students will come up then. Then finally, after three lives, it may happen something. So innovation and discovery is totally different, but research is required, right? Research, I'm telling you research. Because everything is available. I cannot say that this is not available. As I have told you that it is capacity design approach came up 1961, even before that also. Even earlier also, when the construction of the concrete frame and the building design of building came up, then weak beam strong column methodology already available, it was there, but we are highlighting now, we are conveying the message to the everyone, right? So this is that time it was not, nobody were aware. Now because of this computer assisted setup, because we are aware, that is why we want that everyone should be aware, right?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
My question is, sir, in plaster there is a horizontal cracks found, and this correct. Structure is frame structure, and we have provided chicken mesh at RCC and brickwork joint for plaster, and also we provided minimum 15 mm gap of with mortar at top of below bottom of beam, and also there is nothing like a settlement of column. But what could be, sir, other reason for fine cracks horizontally, not some horizontally below the beam? What could be, sir, other reason, sir?
Basically, nowadays the injection grouting is coming up. So whatever literature, means available literature there, so we are normally following in the construction practices also. So injection grouting, etc., etc., every time. And not only that, your damp proofing, DPC will provide. So that way we can basically prevent that slippage part. Especially we will provide at the roof as well as at the ground, as you know, and wherever the toilet, nearby the toilet, kitchen, wherever the possibility of the water can be leak. So there we are going to provide kind of proofing, either damp proofing. Nowadays the chemical also came up, which I also came to know. That they have, I forgot the name of the chemical, they normally use the chemical in the water and then go for their designing. So plastering. So not only your chicken mesh, we are also using the chemical in the water, and then that water we are going using for the plastering. So I forgot the name of the chemical right now. Sorry for that, actually.
Sir, one chemical from Asian Paints coming, sir.
Correct.
Yes. And I mainly want to know, sir, what could be the reason, sir, of this such problem, sir?
One is settlement, other is the thermal. Thermal effect, thermal expansion. You come to
maybe thermal, sir.
Yeah, thermal effect. The plaster can, there is a visible crack will be appear in the plaster. But you have to check from there itself, you have to check it that whether it is going inside the structure or not, whether your reinforcement is visible or not. So if it is visible, then you have to again take the action immediately. There is no time for that. But if any hairline crack appear in the plaster, that is a plastering crack because of the temperature effect. Normally, temperature effect, that is the reason, actually. And for this, normally, we are providing that, which I have told you, epoxy resin. We are also using it for basically removing that plaster. But that is all a temporary solution. Right now, no proper solution. Even if you ask anyone, no proper solution came up. We are using that solution every time, and our Pilani region, there are so much of parivartan is happening. I am also part of that, totally struggling about how to avoid this seepage problem, right? But we are using this, what I have right now shared, even you also told me correctly. Okay, because this is totally seepage prone area, you can say that. It's totally water seepage problem.
Yes.
So, damp proofing.
Hairline crack.
It is basically hairline crack because that is due to the thermal effect. Actually, even in my chamber also it is appear. I am telling you, just after construction of the, I think construction of 1 year, it appeared. But after that, we have provided some epoxy coating. Now it is fine. So this way we are. So now it is after I think 2 years over. It is fine now, working properly. Okay, so seepage problem is a very big problem, but thermal problem is also there because in Rajasthan there is a huge difference between day and night. So 20 degree difference. 20 degree, if now it is 30 degree, then in night you definitely get 10 degree. That much of difference is there. Okay, anyway, and the next question, if any.
Okay, sir. Am I audible to you, sir? Good morning.
Yes.
My name is Gangesh Kumar Thakur, and I am assistant professor in Civil Engineering Department, RVS College, Jamshedpur. And I am also a part-time senior design engineer with a consultant. Oh, so, sir, my question is, I have been through put to design one G+8 building for the
G+8
for the PMAY, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana.
Okay,
and
okay,
in that sir, the unit was three units were there, and it was in shape of H shape. It was in shape of H, and so
A-shape.
What?
H shape is a symmetrical plan.
So we designed three units, and then other side three units which will be follow. So almost everything will be there. So yeah. my question is, sir, the collapse mechanism of the building, if we say so, distance, the offset between two units should be minimum 50 mm, right, sir?
Correct.
And so,
it depends actually how the building, mm-hmm. what is the building, two building height, adjacent two building height.
Yes, sir. Tower.
If it will be different, then delta by two. If it will be same, then delta. You can cross check the code also. As per our IS code provision, we normally focus on that. Yeah.
Okay, so yes. My question is, sir, the land was not available with the client, and so is there anything like we can do to minimize that thing? If the shear wall we are providing, or we are changing the dimension of the columns up to 2 feet.
Why don't you changing the dimension now? If you are not till now the construction happened, why did you not change the plan dimensions? Not the column dimension, plan dimensions. Little bit, because if you are not...
Because when we go for the proof check and all to the NITs, they say something different.
I understood, but if it is not happened right now, approval came?
It is still in approval. And the second problem is that we used ETABs for detailing.
ETABs is different thing. First thing is that you have to first find out which location you are going to construct for your H-shaped building, right?
If your the location itself is Jamshedpur only, so I have done everything according to
the location, the dimension of the plan, dimension of the area, is it sufficient? If the adjacent buildings are very close with each other, then seismic pounding effect may come, because Jamshedpur, is it a seismic zone? What is a seismic zone? Jamshedpur? Zone 3 is moderate, it's okay. But yes, you have to check the earthquake risk. You have to check it also against the earthquake. That is also there. Because as per the 2007 law, it is mandatory nowadays. Earthquake resistant check will be required. But if it is not very close, only 50 mm, I don't think that there will be any problem. But if the problem is coming up, then better to just change your direct orientation of the plan.
That's what we suggested. Like, we should like work on the plan itself, like the start.
Because reinforcement, provision of reinforcement, etc. detailing, it will be coming later on. That is individual building. But first thing is that first and foremost thing is that there should not have any kind of seismic pound effect if the earthquake really happen. वो बहुत डेंजरस हो जाता है फायर जल जाएगा फिर आपके
बट दे हैव नॉट मच ऑफ लैंड एंड कॉस्ट इज आल्सो अ रिक्वायरमेंट ना बिकॉज़ द पीएमएवाई लाइक दे हैव द कॉस्ट
यू कैन प्रोसीड बट सपोज इट इज द फार्मर लैंड इज देयर देन यू कैन नॉट गेट इट यू वोंट गेट इट द फार्मर लैंड इफ इट इज अ फार्मर लैंड देन यू वोंट गेट इट इफ इट इज अ इंडिविजुअल आई एम नॉट श्योर दैट हाउ डू यू मैनेज बट सपोज इफ इट इज नॉट मैनेजेबल देन यू आइदर वन ऑप्शन इज दैट चेंज द ओरिएंटेशन ऑफ द प्लान or shortage of the plan, means shortening of the plan, dimension, or what else? You change the means number of buildings, at least you have to maintain always that distance between two buildings, so the seismic pounding effect should not happen, right?
Yes, so this is I got a little idea. I have got like, I wanted something from the experts. So I have got the things like, now I am satisfied with my mental picture also, what I am going to suggest them.
No, whatever you have thought, it is totally correct only. First thing is that orientation of the plan or shortening of the plan, or if it is not happening, then number of buildings or building orientation, or building orientation also, there is another chance, building orientation also, vertically, not horizontally, vertically also. So yes, that way, so these are the options are there so that the seismic pounding effect should not occur. But here, zone 3, nobody bothers. But yes, you have to show it, because nowadays earthquake resistance structure in every
it is necessary. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is necessary. Yeah, so mandatory now.
It is regulatory. Yes. The law says
mandatory. Yes, sir.
In court mein aapka ye chala jayega case. Okay. Anyway.
And my second question is, sir, one pedestrian I was supposed to design him for the Delhi, right, sir? Okay. And so time history analysis is need to be done for this thing, a pedestrian.
Pedestrian. Okay, yes, zone 5. Delhi is zone 4. Okay. Zone 4 means very high seismic region, and Delhi is shortage of land. So, pedestrian, aapko time history chahiye pedestrian ke liye. Yeah, kyun zarurat hai?
I don't know.
Pedestrian is normal tiles, na? Normal pavement pavers, right? You are providing there. Pedestrian, mm-hmm. or you are basically making the proper flexible or rigid pavement. Means or hybrid pavement. What you are actually?
It's a flexible over the flexible pavement.
Okay, and you are providing a footpath also, right?
Yeah, and we actually the thing is that we are not supplied with the soil data also. Like we need 9 boreholes and all the things also. So that is the thing. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Because they cannot like go for the 9 course, no. So it's still like 9 boreholes, 9 meter. Yeah, up to 9 meter we wanted. And
I understood your point. Better to go for your time history analysis. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I understood. Because there are different points, different little, means if you just away, little away, your time history will be changed. And if the time history will be changed, the acceleration point of view will be changed. So, and there is a chance to road can be going into the inelastic region. There is a chance. So basically, because of the high seismic zone. So, better to just, because P delta, although here no P delta effect will come, but yes, it is normal road, but why don't you just check it if you have that option?
Yeah, sir, it will, if softwares also have these options nowadays, ETAPS 21. Yeah, yes. So we can do that. Sir. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Good day, correct. Is there anything else?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Am I audible?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, my name is Suleiman. Mm-hmm. I'm from Jammu and Kashmir. I'm assistant professor at MIT.
So, okay.
Sir, my nice question to meet you. Is, thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you, same here. Sir, my question is regarding shear wall.
Correct.
Sir, is it sufficient to give a single shear wall in a multi-story structure, like 20 stories or 30 stories?
Is there any problem? Means because there are, if you check the shear wall thoroughly in the literature, there are three different shear wall. One is known as a squat shear wall. Squat shear wall, it is a aspect ratio is very low, right? It basically known as a squat shear. Squat, S-Q-U-A-T. Then second one is a moderate, and then the slender shear wall. So slender shear wall, high-rise buildings, it is fine only. But normally we prefer that couple shear walls. But that depends on the walls are, two walls are in the same plane or not. And there is a small gap in between two shear wall, two wall or not. Then only you go for the couple shear wall system. Otherwise, you can provide the normal shear wall from either roof to bottom. Yeah.
Sir, in normal buildings like G plus 5, G plus 6, the single shear wall behaves well.
Mm-hmm.
But when the story increases, naturally the seismic wave...
It is slender. Shear wall is becoming slender. Overturning effect will come. More moment is coming at the base. Right?
Yes, sir.
So because of the reason, we prefer the couple shear wall effect. Because of the reason. So couple shear wall, what is basically do, what is does, you have to, for this, when you provide the couple shear wall, so one shear wall you have provided, so that shear wall will be connected with the coupling beam, and that coupling beam, the other side of the coupling beam will connect with the other shear wall. So that way it will balance with each other, right? And you can say that that overturning effect is also drastically reduced at the base. So the moment is also coming, overturning moment at the base is coming, means although very high, but basically you are providing the more stiffness against the lateral load in plane. So definitely it can resist it very easily.
Sir, I am asking that will the single shear wall act very well?
First thing is that shear wall. So my answer is that you have to first provide the shear wall in that particular structure, and then check what is happening from your design point of view. Then, if you are not able to make it satisfy, then you go for the couple shear wall action. But remember, couple shear wall will be only there when the another shear wall will be coming in same plane, right? And the coupling beam also will come in the same plane, and that means the wall should be there. If wall should not be there, then one shear wall you have to provide, the other side also you have to provide the other. So you have to provide the shear wall in a symmetric way.
Okay.
Just a minute. Hold on. You have that confusion still. Just a minute. Hold on. Although I have shown you in the plan. Hold on. I think, yeah. Now see this.
Yes, sir.
See this. This is randomly we have provided the shear wall location. This is not good. Similarly, which you are telling that only one shear wall you are providing. Suppose if I providing here the shear wall, the other bay is no shear wall, then definitely the problem will come up. The torsional effect will come up because shear wall, the gravity load will be very more. It will take too much of load. And shear wall itself will be very stiff. So there is a chance to torque will can come. So and overturning effect is also there. So that is why you have to provide in a symmetric, to maintain the symmetry, the one more shear wall in the other bay, other extreme bay, the other side where I am moving my arrow. Are you getting my?
Yes, sir. I am getting.
Yeah. So here you provide it. Any other doubt? I hope that this doubt has been clear.
Yes, sir. Is there any fixed location to provide shear wall?
You have to provide a shear wall in a symmetric way. That's it.
Okay.
You have to provide a shear wall in a very symmetric way. Either you provide in the core, inside core, all four bays.
In a tube form. We can say in a tube form.
I'm sorry?
Sir, we can say that we can provide it in a tube form. Correct.
No. That is okay. You have to, but always you have to maintain the symmetry and also optimum number of shear walls. Because shear wall construction of shear wall is costly.
Yes, sir.
So overall cost of the building is very huge then. So that is why you have to make it optimum, but at the same time symmetry, so that the structure should not collapse. Structure should not be damaged. Even after providing the shear wall.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Hello, sir. I am Sankit Sanghai. I am from Maharashtra, and I have a doubt regarding performance-based design, sir. Can you consider the effect of soil structure interaction for the performance-based design?
Very good questions. Performance-based design can be applicable not only structure. Performance-based design can be applicable in the soil also. Performance-based design can be applicable to the road also. Performance-based design can be applicable in the bridge also. Performance-based design can be applicable to the that is your marine structures also. So everywhere performance-based design can be applicable. So when it is a soil structure interaction problem, just like a dam structure, there also you can provide this performance-based design. Who stop you, right?
Okay. Which effects can we consider? Means soil structure interaction also have some soil flexibility, soil
infiltration. Correct. Let me finish my answer. All the effects you have to consider. All the effects you have to consider in your design. And then you check.
Okay. So we can consider all these effects, no?
Yes. Okay. Otherwise, how do you make sure that your design is correct? The dam which are going to be constructed in the in that particular site, it will be correct. It will behave correct means properly for the next 30 years. If you provide the design life as 30 years, so for 30 years there won't be any damage appears.
Okay.
How do you make sure that? Until and unless you will consider all the parameters which are basically governing.
Mm-hmm.
So that you have to consider it, no?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah. Good morning.
I am Sumit Thakur from Maharashtra.
Okay. Nice to meet you, Mr. Okay. Sumit.
Thanks, sir. I am currently working on energy dissipating devices which will resist the lateral loads.
Oh, energy dissipating device means damping. Damper?
Yes, sir. In that, I am specifically working on buckling with spindle braces.
Okay, bracing. Okay.
Ah, bracing.
Means is a bracing? Is a bracing with dampers, right?
Yes, sir. It's part of a damper.
Kind of tune must dampers. Kind of tune must dampers. I hope yes, that sir. Or oil yes. damper.
So specifically, we are going to place it diagonal direction. But yeah. my question is that, sir, is it having a little bit importance in construction industry and in which zone it is normally considered? Is it for high seismicity zones or?
Very good question. Nowadays, the practice has already been started all over India. Okay. Right? Wherever the high seismic zones, we are basically using this concept. Okay. So, if it is high seismic zones, you have you must use this. You must use this. That is mandatory. But yes, you have to check after designing that considering the design concept which I just now discussed that whether it is mandatory or not. Then only you procure from the market and provide it there. That how many number of dampers or damping device in the bracing will be provided. And how it will be provided, what will be the total cost, everything will be also involved. But yes, nowadays the safety, life safety also involved. Nobody now, even India also, nobody bothers, even compromise this, it's not bothers, compromise this safety, especially okay. life safety also.
Okay.
So government is also, I think, giving, I mean, they are also providing more money actually. Anyway, yeah, okay. please.
Sir, any insights related with installation of BRBs to resist lateral loads in India or any case study, you know, which happened recently?
See, this is a very good question. Installation, normally the expertise, there are some expertise involved, right?
Okay.
We are the not just designers, structural designers. I am a structural dynamics fellow. I do not know the installation. And since I am a most theoretical person, I am telling you, most theoretical, because I am a teacher. So mainly I'm involved for this teaching. So I know the theory, but I know a little bit practical because of the, I am involved in the project Parivartan here going on in our campus as a faculty in church. So, but now that is my, that I'm fortunate to learn those things also. But others are not fortunate. Those, my colleagues are also not fortunate that way. But yes, as a structural designers, how to install, normally we depends on the expertise, but when you at the site, it better to learn from the expertise who are coming. Maybe first time they can come, later on you should learn. That is my suggestion.
Okay,
because
sir.
When the expertise will come, that after till that time you have to wait, then they're gone. Then project will be delayed for a like anything actually. I do not know, maybe. Right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So better to do expertise in that particular part also. So when you are acting as a site engineer, not as a structural designer, also as a site engineer. Yeah.
Okay, surely, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes. That is my just request, suggestion. Because I am also feeling every day here.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Is there any other question? Otherwise.
Professor?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, Muthu Kumar is already posted in chat box. In continuation, I just asking
oh,
with this.
Okay.
I just have a doubt on finding the performance point. You have told us something that performance point by comparing the capacity curve and the response vector for meeting points or something. For the capacity curve, if I find from experimental model, while testing the research, conducting research on beam or column or so and so things, if I get the capacity curve, so whether I can compare with that, can I get the capacity point, performance point?
No.
Is there an approach?
What do we normally do it? We normally design a structures that you know. Design a structures means what? We are providing the strength, right? We are providing the sufficient amount of strength to the structure. That is known as design. Or we are providing the capacity to the structure in terms of strength, stiffness, etc., etc. Right? And then when we are designing it, then we are getting the base shear, we are getting the structural displacements, right?
Yes,
and
yes.
That you have to plot it. So when we are plotting, because structures maybe within the elastic limit, structure maybe beyond the elastic limit. So we have to basically design the structure in such a way so that we should get the capacity curve which can link between elastic point to the inelastic point. So that is known as your design curve. And that point, that design curve will be done till we achieve the final point, that is collapse prevention point. Just after that, it will collapse. So till that particular point, that is known as the design curve, which totally depends on your how much capacity you have provided to the structure. And this particular curve you can generate either using the Excel spreadsheet, either using the MATLAB, either nowadays the software, anywhere you can use, means you can model it and generate this capacity curve. Then after getting this capacity curve, you have to convert into the capacity spectrum as per that performance-based design procedure. So that capacity spectrum is normally, it is basically SA and SD, right? SA is the spectral acceleration and SD is the spectral displacement, which is known as also pseudo displacement. Spectral displacement, right?
Yeah.
And that there is a equations which also given in your any textbook, anywhere you can get it. Even in the Google, nowadays the Google is available. You can check it also. You can directly get it. How we can convert the VB to SA and the root displacement or structural displacement into the SD, right?
Yeah.
Then after getting this capacity spectrum, then you have to consider, because that particular structure you are going to construct in a particular region, in a particular zone, like a Roorkee, like a Delhi, like Pelani, like nearby your region, like nearby your region is Perumbudur, right? I forgot. I think it is Perumbudur.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyhow. So, so there itself, so you have to construct. Now, when you construct it, you have to check it that whether the structure can sustain or not, right? Which you have designed it. So for this, you have to consider that location, the response spectrum graph. Now, why it is response spectrum graph? Although it is nonlinear, but when we are considering the response spectrum graph, that is linear. That is linear because response spectrum is only valid for a linear behavior of the structure or elastic behavior of structure, which obeys the Hooke's law.
Yes, then, within the elastic.
Yes. Then that response, why response spectrum, why not time history? Time history also you can use it, but response spectrum is basically nothing but the maximum acceleration for that particular zone. You will get it at a time.
Yeah.
That is linearly combined. Linearly addition and all points are maximum acceleration in that particular zone and considering the single degree of freedom system, right? So that response spectrum graph you will consider from your IS code, from you can generate with your own also. That is a micro generation, etc. So many things are coming up nowadays. So you can directly hire from your IS code. That is 5% damped response spectra, and that you will consider, and then you have to convert into the demand spectrum. Demand spectrum, right? Demand curve, demand spectrum. That is SA by yeah. ST. Again, SA versus SD. Again, that in that particular graph, that is a common common graph. SA versus SD. If I'm going back, I think my slide is visible. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes, yes.
How serious? This is SA by SD. Now, the green color is demand curve. Now, this demand curve going into the elastic design spectrum. That is SA by SD. So, we have to convert it. There is a formula, which I told you that Google or the textbook, Anil Chopra book, is a very best book. There you will get this idea. This idea is given. Then, since we know that the capacity curve which you have here drawn, that is considering the inelastic behavior of the structures, so we have to also convert into the inelastic design spectrum. So how to do it? For this, we have to draw this inelastic design spectrum, which is showing in a fluorescent color.
And an ideal spectrum.
Yes. And this spectrum is normally divided by mu. Mu is the ductility. And this method is available in the Anil Chopra chapter number 7. Just check it out.
I will follow.
Just check it out. Chapter number 6 and chapter number 7. Just check it out. You will get it very easy. Very easy. No problem at all.
Okay.
Then when it will commit. So now mu for what? Ductility for what?
Ductility.
Ductility for this structure. The structure which you have considered, the design you have made it. That structure only. That structure ductility. Yes. So you have to divide. So you will get it reduced design spectrum. Then that reduced design spectrum where it is intersect or bisects the capacity curve. That point is known as the performance point.
Performance. Okay. Fine.
Okay. And that performance point shows the seismic performance level. Now, can you tell me which level it is? If you remember that level, which I have shown, which level it is, I can say. Is it life safety or it will be in between intermediate, immediate occupancy level and the life safety? In between, I think. Life safety somewhere else.
Life.
In between.
Immediate occupancy.
So towards the life safety, we can say, right?
Yes.
So that will be the seismic performance. And when and corresponding to the SA, corresponding to the performance point SA, we'll get it directly the force level. And that force level, from that force level, we can understand that which type of earthquake or which type of natural hazard can occur this type of performance point of this structure.
Okay.
Whether it will be rare, whether it will be very rare, whether it will be a frequent earthquake, whether it will be an intermediate earthquake.
Okay.
Understood?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I've got it.
I hope that this is finally got it.
Yes, yes, sir. I got an idea about it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
Professor.
Thank you. Anything else?
So, if there are no other questions, can we conclude the session, sir?
Thank you very much. Thank you
for
giving this opportunity.
Yes, sir. So, on behalf of SPC and all the participants present here, I'd like to thank Professor Dipendu Punia for this wonderful session and also for his patience in answering to all the questions posed by the participants. So, thank you, sir, for your extremely informative session. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. Yeah. Have a nice time.
Thank you, sir.